This is the colloquium by Professor Jan de Boer, University of Amsterdam. Let me take 1 minute and a half to tell you briefly about his CV. Jan studied his undergraduate and master degrees in Groningen, then the PhD in Utrecht, finished in 1993. Then he held very prestigious postdoctoral fellowships in Stony Brook until 96, and then in California, in Berkeley, California, until 99. Then became faculty in Leiden and the Spinoza Institute, then full professor in Amsterdam in 2000, and since then he's there. Jan has been advisor to over 10 PhD theses, wrote around 150 papers in many different topics of theoretical physics, among which CFTs, fundamental aspects of holography, condensed matter theory, mathematical physics, physical mathematics, and most notably on different aspects of black holes, topic of which he's a world-renowned expert. Most importantly, perhaps, is that every colleague who ever discussed physics with Jan comes out recognizing his quality and his multiple insights. So after this introduction, I pass it to Jan. Thanks very much. Welcome.
Thanks for the kind words. It's a great pleasure to be here to give you this colloquium. I couldn't think of a better way to celebrate my 28th wedding anniversary. So, so in this colloquium, this will be a slightly kaleidoscopic type of colloquium, but I want to give you a flavor of some recent developments that have to do with the interface between quantum gravity, chaos, complexity, and statistical physics. For those people here who are participating in the school, you will see some similarities and maybe some overlaps if things that were appeared in lectures, but in principle, it's an independent colloquium. No, that's a lot of delay. Maybe. It worked 5 minutes ago. Well, just a second, maybe I need to share again. It stopped, for some reason, it stopped working. What happened? I don't want to do that. What's the problem? Let me try once more. I first need to go presentation mode. The other way to do it is control. Resume slideshow. Okay. And now, yes. Good. Here we are. I don't know. Some little hiccup. So sorry about the little hiccup. So as I was saying, this is supposed to give you a flavor of some recent developments that are in the interface between quantum gravity, chaos, and complexity, and so on. So here's the outline of this colloquium. I'll first say a few general things about quantum gravity. Then I'll briefly say a few things about the AdS-CFT correspondence. If you want to know more about it, in next week's colloquium, the inventor of AdS-CFT will speak, so this is the right person to ask all the annoying questions to. Then I'll briefly say something about observables in AdS and black holes in AdS, and then I'll discuss three puzzles that appear in gravity and also possible resolutions of those three puzzles. So here, first I want to say a few basic things about quantum gravity. So as recent experimental observations have shown and confirmed, although we already knew that theoretically, space and time are not rigid phenomena, they move. And in particular, you can have gravitational ripples, gravitational waves propagating through the universe. And this was confirmed in a spectacular way by the LIGO-Virgo collaboration, who saw the gravitational waves that were being emitted by colliding black holes. So this, if nothing else, is experimental proof that space and time fluctuate. It is not some static thing. This is, however, all classical. If you want to think about quantum gravity, things get more complicated. Because if space and time are dynamical, they should in particular also be quantum. Some people have tried to see if you can couple a classical space-time to quantum physics and treat space-time classically and the rest of the world quantum mechanically. That's kind of an inconsistent description of nature. So the only thing that kind of makes sense is that if all the matter fields and electrons and everything are given by quantum mechanics, is that space-time itself is also quantum mechanical. That means that the shape and the size of the universe is not given by a really well-defined phenomenon. It's given by some wave function with some probability distribution. And that means that space and time are intrinsically fuzzy. Now, if space and time are intrinsically fuzzy, then it's unclear how to even start defining anything. Because if you have a fuzzy cloud of geometry, how do you even define a point? A point is not well defined because space and time fluctuate. So how do you even begin to make sense of the theory of quantum gravity from first principles, especially if you want to do something that is, say, non-perturbative? How would you even define the problem? Therefore, it's one of the great challenges of theoretical physics is to come up precisely with such a consistent theory of quantum gravity. And you could ask, why care? These days, if you apply for grants, they always have to write an impact paragraph, and then you have to explain why it's important for society and what the societal impact is and how it addresses the sustainable development goals of the United Nations and so on. This does none of that. This is because it's quantum gravity, and we're just curious. We want to know how the world works. We would like to understand how black holes work, what is going on inside the black hole once you cross the horizon. We would like to understand the origin of the universe. In order to understand the origin of the universe, you also need to have a good understanding of quantum gravity. And then, as always, there is serendipity. You never know, you might run into some surprises along the way. And why is it a difficult problem? That is, because if we put on our quantum field theory hat and we use that approach to study general relativity, you'll find that general relativity is perturbatively non-renormalizable, and you can't really define it non-perturbatively. Moreover, it's widely believed that general relativity is only a low-energy effective field theory, so it's not a fundamental theory. It is valid up to some energy scale, and then it's unclear what happens above. And it's also difficult because, as I said, if space-time itself is given by some wave function and everything fluctuates, then how do you define observables to begin with? And black holes are in particular, they're sometimes called the harmonic oscillator of quantum gravity because they're sort of the simplest system that poses very interesting sharp questions for us. And in particular, one of the most important questions in black hole physics is to understand the nature of the singularity that exists once you cross the event horizon. Now, we know a few things about black holes that we learned in the 1970s, and those are the laws of black hole mechanics. And the laws of black hole mechanics, they just follow from studying the Einstein equations. They just follow from general relativity. And one of those lessons is that black holes have no hair. That basically means that it's impossible for a black hole to have any particular feature. If you closely look at the geometry near horizon, all black holes are exactly indistinguishable from each other. They don't have particular features. They are kind of featureless objects. A second thing that was observed is that it looks like black holes carry some sort of entropy. An entropy which is equal to the area divided by 4 times the Newton constant. It is entropy between quotation marks Because in order to use the word entropy, we need to have some sort of thermodynamical description of the system. And this is classical general relativity. So at first sight, there's no entropy to talk about it, just some classical solution of some classical field equation. However, the reason why we think entropy is a reasonable word to use to describe this is because black holes also have a temperature. This was shown by Hawking. If you look at the black hole, any black hole radiates at a certain temperature. To see that, you have to go beyond general relativity. To see that, you have to put quantum field theory in the background of a black hole, do computations in that quantum field theory, and then perturbative computations in that quantum field theory will reveal that black holes have a temperature. Because black holes have a temperature, it suggests that maybe they also have an entropy and maybe they behave like a thermodynamic system. And in fact, the relation between the mass of the black hole, the entropy of the black hole, and the temperature is exactly like in thermodynamics. So the relation is precisely analogous to the relation you know from thermodynamics, and that strongly suggests that black holes, although at first sight are just classical solutions of the field equations, are in fact thermodynamical systems. And this is sometimes referred to these days as like the central dogma. It's an important assumption, an important starting point, is to take this point of view seriously and to really think that this entropy between quotation marks is really an entropy without quotation marks. It's an actual entropy. It's counting some set of microscopic degrees of freedom. The standard cartoon explanation for why black holes Hawking radiate is because in the vacuum, as in this picture, in the vacuum, you always create spontaneously pairs of particles and antiparticles. You have virtual processes. And then the idea is that if you have a virtual process and the antiparticle goes behind the horizon, then the particle can escape. And in this way, you can create particles out of nothing. This is not a very precise mathematical explanation of Hawking radiation. It's a cartoon. It is also slightly misleading sometimes. But this is one way to crudely think about it. Now, this Hawking radiation gives rise to a very sharp paradox, which is called the information paradox. And the information paradox is the following apparent problem. Namely, suppose that you start with a pure state in quantum mechanics. It's just a single state. And suppose that that state describes a distribution of matter in the universe. And suppose you collapse all that matter on top of each other, then you make a black hole. That black hole will, in principle, Hawking radiate until it has been completely evaporated. And if you believe Hawking's computation, the final result of this process is a mixed state. It's not a pure state, it's a mixed state. Because what comes out of the black hole is thermal radiation. And Hawking's computation remains reliable until the black hole is super, super small. And maybe all the way at the end is like a slight deviation, but that can never save the fact that this final state appears to be a mixed state. And if you believe that the world should have unitary time evolution, then it's impossible for a pure state to evolve into a mixed state. This does not happen in quantum mechanics. So this seems to contradict basic laws of quantum mechanics, and led Hawking to originally suggest that maybe the laws of quantum mechanics are wrong and that they should be replaced, if you have a gravitational theory, by something more complicated, where in fact pure states can evolve into mixed states. But clearly that is a very drastic deviation from everything that we know and love about quantum mechanics, but I'll come back to that later. Now, you might think that, well, Hawking did his computation in a certain approximation. Maybe if you just do things slightly more carefully, maybe you have to do a higher order loop diagram in the field theory, or maybe you need to include some higher order corrections to general relativity, and then surely everything will be fine. But that turns out to not be true. If you include some higher order corrections in the computation, you can still argue on general grounds that you still get a violation of unitarity and you still have a situation where a pure state evolves into a mixed state. So there seems to be a fundamental conflict between having unitarity, locality, which goes into all of this, and the equivalence principle, which says that if you're a freely falling observer, locally you see nothing special. The equivalence principle tells you that the black hole horizon behaves like an empty place, because you should see nothing special if you fall through. That's what the equivalence principle tells you. The fact that the horizon is not a special place was used in Hawking's computation because he trusted general relativity. And you use local quantum field theory to do your computation, so you also assume locality. And if you then also, but then, so if you assume locality and the equivalence principle, you find the violation of unitarity. So you cannot have all these three things at the same time. One of these three things needs to give. Now, it was suggested a couple of years ago by these four authors that the thing that should go is the equivalence principle. And that generically, if you approach the horizon of a black hole, it will not be an empty place, but some really horrible thing is waiting there for you. It's called a firewall. It's some sort of region of very high energy that would obliterate you the instant you hit the horizon. That has led to a lot of debate, and I would say that right now the majority of the field does not believe that this is the right answer to this particular paradox. I'll say a bit more about it later. Another important lesson that we learned from black holes is the fact that the entropy of a black hole is proportional to the area of the horizon and not proportional to the volume. And that's very different from how information is stored in a non-gravitational system. In a non-gravitational system, the amount of information you can store is proportional to the volume. If you have a USB stick with some information on it, and you have a box, you can fill it completely with USB sticks. And if you have two boxes, you fill the second one also with USB. And clearly, you know, the amount of information scales with the volume. That's in a non-gravitational theory. However, if you have a gravitational theory and you keep on stacking boxes of USB sticks on top of each other, by the time you have made a humongous mountain of such boxes filled with USB sticks, the total mass of that mountain will be large enough that the whole thing will collapse into a black hole. So you cannot keep on going stacking boxes of USB sticks on top of each other. And fundamentally, this, the fact that the entropy of a black hole is proportional to the horizon area, that seems to be a fundamental principle, and it tells you that the degrees of freedom of a quantum gravitational theory are intrinsically non-local. If they were local, we would have expected the entropy of a system like this to scale with the volume, not with the area. So it tells you something about the non-locality of the degrees of freedom. And this non-locality and the fact that the volume gets replaced by the area, that is sometimes called the holographic principle. It's called the holographic principle because it seems to tell us that we can store all the information about the inside of a black hole in a local description on the horizon. And there would be enough information available there to encode everything that goes on inside. So the general idea is that everything that happens in the universe can efficiently be encoded on a screen which is one dimension less. And this reduction of the number of degrees of freedom is because the world is a gravitational place. So this is just another picture that illustrates that. If we were to put local qubits somewhere on the sphere, then the number, like the total entropy of this ball would roughly be given by the area. And the statement is that the entropy of a black hole is given by such a quantity. And therefore, this is just a different way to phrase what the holographic principle is. So, after each little thing, I will have a little take-home message. So if you phase out and fall asleep, you just need to read the take-home message and you can couple back in again. But basically, the wish list for any theory of quantum gravity is that it should ideally explain the entropy of a black hole in terms of some microscopic degrees of freedom. Because if it's truly the entropy, then we should have, just like for a gas in a box, we should be able to derive the entropy of the system from some microscopic description. And this is certainly, if we claim to have a microscopic description of a quantum gravitational theory, this is something we would like to have. We would also like our description to resolve the information paradox and to explain which of those three criteria actually has to go. What is the actual contradiction and how is it resolved? It should also ideally explain precisely what happens to an infalling observer. It should be compatible with this holographic principle, and it should explain what happens at the black hole singularity. These are just some requirements for any theory of quantum gravity. Now, there is something, it's called the ADS-CFT correspondence, which is a very useful technical setup that allows us to address these questions in more detail. And the main idea of the ADS-CFT correspondence is that we start with a gravitational theory in flat space, but we put the gravitational theory in essentially a box. And the box has the feature that quantum fluctuations, as you go towards the boundary of the box, they die out. So that's illustrated here with these red wiggles. It's a bit like having an effective potential barrier near the boundary. So if something is very quantum in the middle of ADS, as you go towards the boundary, it will start, the quantum fluctuations will become less and less. And by the time you go all the way to the boundary of the box, the fluctuations will have gone. And that such a box exists, and that's a bit of a miracle. And this box is basically called ADS. And what is so great about it is that because these quantum fluctuations die out near the boundary of this box, space and time start to become more and more, less and less quantum, because the fluctuations die out. And once you make it all the way to the boundary of the box, space and time become well-defined, because there's no quantum fluctuation anymore. And that means that although in the middle everything just fluctuates and behaves like in any theory of quantum gravity, once you go towards the boundary, you have a well-defined notion of space and time. And this is, so now you have something to hold on to. Now you can define some sort of observable. You have something that's well-defined. Whereas if you sit in the middle of ADS, there's nothing really well-defined because everything is quantum. So this box allows you to study what goes on in the inside with precision. This box is realized in a practical sense by putting space-time on a non-trivial manifold. So you make space-time non-trivial. This e to the 2r that stands here is basically a bit like this potential well that you see there. But one important message is that as long as you stay close to the bottom of this potential, pretty much everything looks like flat space. So any process that happens sort of locally in the middle of this potential doesn't care too much about what happens near the boundaries and should be, approximate physics in flat space very closely. So in principle, the sort of questions you would like to answer in flat space are available here. However, the place where we can properly define things is far away from it. It's on the boundary. This is just a different picture of this box, which shows you that there is some growth towards the boundary because these red and blue triangles and shapes, they all have the same area. But this exponential growth near the boundary is illustrated with this picture. Now the idea is, so now we have this box with a boundary. And now the idea is to postulate, since on the boundary you have a well-defined notion of space and time, now you can postulate that maybe there is a well-defined quantum system on the boundary that describes everything that goes on in the inside. And there are two reasons to believe that that's not a completely ridiculous idea. First of all, space and time on the boundary are well-defined, so you could have a quantum system that sits there, maybe just a quantum field theory. The second reason why it's not crazy is that although it seems like you lost a dimension, there's a general feature in general relativity is that the Hamiltonian is always equal to zero plus a boundary term. That's a special feature of any gravitational theory. And therefore, all the dynamics could in fact happen on the boundary because the Hamiltonian is really zero in any gravitational theory. Also, as I said before, the entropy of a black hole scales with the area, not with the volume. So if you have an ordinary quantum theory in one dimension less, the scaling of the degrees of freedom is with the area, because it's extensive on the boundary, but the boundary has one dimension less, and therefore extensivity on the boundary gives you precisely this area scaling in the interior. Now, this is all some evidence. Then without doing anything detailed, you can go through a series of steps that I will all skip. These are all arguments that you can do semi-classically. They don't require a full UV complete theory. But just by thinking about any theory that you put in this box, you can derive various properties that any quantum system that lives on the boundary must have. And I don't want to really go through this list. It's not so important. The thing is that there are many properties of these quantum theories that can be derived universally without relying on the microscopic description. It just follows from semi-classical thinking. In particular, there you can also do, you can approach quantum gravity from different points of view. I like string theory a lot, but there are other people in the world that like to approach quantum gravity from a different point of view. I think no matter which point of view you take, you should always find all these items when you apply your favorite quantum gravitational approach to ADS, because this just follows from semi-classical reasoning. And if you want your approach to quantum gravity to agree with semi-classical physics, then all these things should hold. But this is just, these are qualitative features. It does not prove that you in fact have a local quantum system on the boundary. And this is where the breakthrough of 25 years ago, that's the reason why we have the school and this workshop right now, it's called Holography at 25. The main breakthrough was in 1997 when Maldacena showed that if you start from string theory, you can derive this statement top down. This was just some semi-classical reasoning, but you can actually find concrete examples that are all inspired and coming from string theory, where you can show that particular gravitational theories in ADS must be exactly equal to well-defined quantum field theories that are associated to this boundary. And this is a very strong statement, because it states that a quantum field theory in D dimensions is exactly equal to a quantum gravitational theory in D plus one dimensions in these very special situations. So that's great. It's unfortunate that right now we don't have a similar strong statement in other spacetimes. So this is a very special case. We have this box. It has this nice boundary. You can define a quantum field here on the boundary and show in some cases that it's equal to a quantum gravitational system. If you replace spacetime by flat space or by the Sitter space or by some other cosmological spacetime, we don't have a similar description. So in particular, a full non-perturbative quantum gravitational description of the type of universe we live in is still lacking. But if you want to ask questions, say what happens to a black hole in our universe that evaporates and it's locally all flat spacetime, we might as well study that by putting that system in the middle of this box. As long as the system is not too large, it shouldn't really matter what happens very far away. So this is the take-home message of this. So quantum gravity in ADS is equivalent to some quantum system that lives on the boundary. They really are equal to each other. You can derive many features by just doing semi-classical reasoning. You don't need string theory or anything like that. But if you want a more precise statement, a microscopically precise statement, then you can get those from string theory. And what you get from string theory does obviously agree with all the semi-classical expectations that you can derive model in a model-independent way. Now you want to study things. So now you want to think about observables in ADS. The only things that are well-defined are things that live on the boundary. So the only thing you can compute are things that are living on the boundary. And it's a priori difficult to see what the relation is between some stuff on the boundary and stuff that sits in the middle of your spacetime, because you can only define things on the boundary. So the type of things you can compute is you have a quantum field theory that lives on the boundary of this box. You can put some operators there and compute a correlation function. And since we have an equivalence between the quantum gravitational theory and the quantum field theory, we can either compute a correlation function in the field theory, which might be easier or hard, But we might also equivalently try to compute it in the gravitational theory. And the fact that these two things are equal to each other should tell us something. The quantum gravitational description of such a correlation function is just kind of given by Feynman diagrams in the spacetime. So it includes some vertices and some propagators and so on. So you have some operators there and you just propagate things in the middle, you let them and so on talk to each other. So it's really a bit like medical imaging. It's like this ADS space is like a big MRI scanner. You can't really see what's going. If you stick your leg in an MRI scanner, you can't really see literally in your leg. You shoot things through it. And from the information that you get, you try to reconstruct what's happening in your leg. This is a bit similar. We compute things on the boundary. We cannot go directly in the interior. But from the information that you gather in this way, you try to reconstruct what's going on the inside. Now, very often, if you could compute, you just came in the right time, Herman, this is, you're mentioned here. Now you can go again, because I think... If it's alphabetical, so you're the last one. Yeah. So if you were able to compute these correlation functions directly in this quantum field theory, you might have discovered, if you were powerful enough, that they also allow a description in the gravitational theory in one-dimensional higher. And the way this should, in principle, come about is that you see this extra direction that moves you away from the boundary has to do with scale transformations in the boundary theory. So changing the radial position has something to do with scale transformations. So a slightly different way to think about it is that the gravitational theory that sits in this box contains this extra coordinate, and it somehow is a geometrization of scale invariance. You replace the fact that you can rescale things by some extra coordinate. And in that sense, sometimes people call this that space-time is emergent. Now, it's food for philosophers whether this is really emergence or not. And I'm not a philosopher, so I don't want to discuss that. Another computation you can do is you can compute, in this language, you can compute the partition function of the field theory at finite temperature. If you have a quantum system and you want to compute the partition function at finite temperature, so you want to compute trace E minus beta times H, what you can do is you can take the time coordinate, make it imaginary or Euclidean, and then you make it periodic with period beta, which is the inverse temperature. So if you want to do a computation of this type in this context, what you want to do is you want to make the boundary, you go to this boundary theory, this field theory, you take the time coordinate and you make it periodic, Euclidean and periodic. So here you see this time coordinate, you don't see the other directions of the quantum field theory, you just see the time coordinate. And then you have to glue in some gravitational solution, which in these cases always looks a bit like this cigar geometry. And then you compute the partition function of that cigar geometry by simply computing the classical action, and then you get a very good approximation to the partition function of the field theory. So a quantum partition function, which in principle can be very complicated, reduces to a classical computation in the gravitational theory. You just have to solve Einstein's equations with some boundary conditions. And I'll return to this picture a bit later. I also wanted to briefly mention that quantum information, for some reason, plays an incredibly important role in quantum gravity. This is, again, slightly philosophical. But maybe one reason that information theory is so important is that many features of general relativity seem to be statistical in nature. Like the classical black hole solution is secretly a statistical system. And whenever you have things like entropy and so on, there's some coarse graining going on. And things like entropy have an information theoretic meaning. So maybe somehow the fact that the gravitational theory has thermodynamic features built in, and it has some coarse graining built in, maybe that is ultimately the reason why information theory is such a powerful tool to use when study gravitational theories. Now, very quickly, how does quantum information show up? Well, quantum information in its simplest version shows up if you think about a Bell pair or an EPR pair or whatever you want to call it. So this is just an entangled state between two qubits. It's 0, 0 plus 1, 1. And what's interesting about entanglement, which entanglement is basically the thing that makes quantum mechanics different from classical physics. Because if you have no entanglement, then classical and quantum physics are not that different from each other, but entanglement makes quantum physics very different from classical physics. Because if you have entanglement, you can correlate things over long distances. So in an EPR pair, as you, I'm sure you all know, is if you measure one of these qubits a billion light years away, then you know that the outcome of that measurement will be correlated with the outcome of my measurement, because they have to be the same, either both 0 or both 1. So there's a correlation between measurements. That's not a causal effect, it's a correlation. You cannot use it to communicate faster than the speed of light. But keep in mind that so entanglement is related to correlations that are not there in a classical system. Now you can try to quantify the amount of entanglement of this type if you wish. You can count how many Bell pairs there are between a system A and a system B. And that thing, which I won't define in detail, is called entanglement entropy. It's very similar to ordinary entropy, except this entropy counts how many Bell pairs are shared between a system A and a system B. And it's some number that you can compute given the precise quantum state you're interested in. Now, a remarkable feature is that in AdS-CFT, quantum entanglement counted in this way gets geometrized. So in a beautiful paper from 2006, Ryuan Takinagi showed that the entanglement entropy in the quantum field theory, and what do we mean by that? By that we mean to take a quantum field theory and you take a spatial region and the rest, so take like a ball here and the rest, you can ask how many Bell pairs are there in my current quantum state between the inside of the ball and the outside of the ball. How many Bell pairs are there available? That quantity, that is the entanglement entropy associated to this region, so it counts how many Bell pairs there are between the region and its complement, and that's counted by entanglement entropy, as I just explained. But it turns out that it's geometrized, and the geometrization is, so take this region B, it sits on the boundary, is that you simply glue a surface onto it. That surface extends in the interior of this box, so it extends inside this ADS space. And you just find the surface with the smallest possible volume, and then you compute A divided by 4G. And that geometrizes quantum information. That's remarkable, because in an actual quantum field theory, if you want to do a quantum field theoretic computation to compute how many Bell pairs there are between a system and its complement, it's a super difficult computation, incredibly complicated. But this geometrical computation is very simple. You just have to do a classical minimization problem. So that's quite remarkable. And this is one of the reasons why gravity somehow geometrizes quantum information. And if you look at this picture and you perturb it somewhat, you can even get linearized Einstein's equations from this picture, just from the fact that geometry, that quantum information is geometrized in gravity. It has also been argued more generally that entanglement is needed to build up any spacetime. The very heuristic explanation could be that, as I said, entanglement gives you correlations. So there is some sort of link between things. So there is a correlation link. And apparently in spacetime, this is implemented by connecting spacetime regions to each other. So there is some peculiar, funny connection between entanglement and spacetimes that are connected or not. And you can do computations where you take two disconnected spacetimes that are described by non-entangled states, And then you entangle those states, and then you ask what the right space-time description of that new state is, and then you find it's a connected geometry. So there is some very deep relation between connected geometries and entanglement. But there is no precise statement right now exactly what type of entanglement corresponds with space, smooth space-time geometries and what type does not. A slogan that's associated to that sometimes is ER equals EPR, where ER refers to an Einstein-Rosen bridge, which is sort of the geometrical connection that goes through a black hole, and EPR is an EPR pair. But that's a slogan. There's no precise mathematical statement there. It's just a slogan that tells you that entanglement has something to do with geometrical connections. And it's amazing that, take any of your favorite quantum information theory concepts. They seem to all have some sort of really interesting gravitational interpretation, which suggests that maybe ultimately quantum gravity can be reformulated purely in information theoretic terms. Maybe gravity is just information theory. But this has not been achieved yet. Moving on, let me briefly say something about a black hole in ADS. So you have this box, and you could put a black hole in it, and you can ask what the description of that system is in terms of the system on the boundary. And it turns out that all that the black hole does is that it heats up the boundary theory. So it puts it at a finite temperature. In slightly more detail, what happens is you put a black hole in ADS. Well, it would start to radiate, because all black holes Hawking radiate. But you have put the system in the box. So the radiation goes towards the boundary, but gets reflected back in. And so you sort of reach an equilibrium situation where you have a black hole that is surrounded by a cloud of thermal radiation. And that thermal radiation goes all the way to the boundary, and that is described in the boundary theory also by a finite temperature system. So there's a precise statement that a black hole in ADS is described by a finite temperature field theory. This I will skip. One thing that is maybe interesting to point out is that if you study these black holes in more detail, you find a few interesting features about black holes. Namely, one interesting thing that you find is that black holes are very chaotic, and they destroy information at an unprecedented rate. This is a very technical slide here, but what it's supposed to illustrate is that if you think about classical chaos is the statement that if you take two trajectories of some particle or whatever, with some initial condition that is separated by a small amount, and you evolve that in time, that these trajectories exponentially diverge. That's classical chaos. That tells you that there is an exponential sensitivity on initial conditions, and the weather is an example of this. And this parameter lambda, by which the separation growth is known as the Lyapunov exponent. You can ask what a quantum version of this kind of statement is. And the quick derivation is that if you look at the dependence of the separation at late times on early times, that's given by this derivative. Let's just take the square of it. Now, this derivative in quantum mechanics gets replaced in classical mechanics gets replaced by this Poisson bracket. And in quantum mechanics, this gets replaced by a commutator. So if you want to diagnose similar exponential behavior in a quantum mechanical theory, you kind of want to look at commutators like this squared. So for example, correlators of this type. That have the interesting feature that they're not ordered in time, right? That's because of this commutator, you don't get things that are ordered in time. And these are called out-of-time ordered correlators. And these out-of-time ordered correlators are a quantum mechanical proxy for measuring this classical Lyapunov exponent. And in a particular case, for example, there's some Lyapunov exponent that appears here. And for a large class of quantum mechanical theories, you can argue that is bound that in quantum mechanics, there's a bound on this Lyapunov exponent. It cannot be arbitrarily large. You have to assume some things about the quantum mechanical theory, but you can argue it's bounded, but also that black holes saturate is bound. So you can define a quantum mechanical version of chaos. you can define a quantum mechanical version of the Lyapunov exponent, and black holes saturate this exponent. So from this point of view, black holes are the most chaotic objects in nature. You cannot have something that's more chaotic than a black hole. There are all kinds of different computations that you can do that all lead to the same conclusion. And that means that there's another computation that you can do, namely that if you throw something into a black hole, it very rapidly is only a Planck distance away from the horizon of the black hole. The Planck distance is the length scale where quantum gravity becomes important. That takes only a relatively short time. And by that time, there's no computation that an outside observer can do to reconstruct what went into the black hole. So basically, if you have a black hole and you throw something in it, all the information seems to disappear in a time scale of this order. And that has to do with the fact that these things are super chaotic. You can imagine that the more chaotic a system is, if you perturb it a little bit, it will spread rapidly through the system, right? Because the faster paths diverge, the more quickly a perturbation will spread itself through the system. So black holes are somehow are champions of information destruction. Now, if you throw something in and the information gets destroyed, we quickly go back to the information paradox. What we would like to see is if you throw something into the black hole, how it comes out later. But all of this tells you that it's very complicated to see something come out at a later point because all this information gets destroyed. You can see that also in correlation functions, they always decay exponentially and it becomes very rapidly very difficult to extract any information. So you can ask, are there other quantities that might allow you to still probe a quantum system once the system has thermalized? So if you perturb a system, you know, it will thermalize, it will distribute over the theory, but is there still a quantity that still does something non-trivial after the thermalization time? And this is where a notion comes in, it's called complexity. And complexity is something that comes from quantum computation, but that seems to be the type of thing that allows you, in principle, to see things even after this scrambling time, even after superficially all the information of anything that you threw in has disappeared. So the precise definition of complexity is as follows. It's a slightly annoying definition, but not so hard. It's just quantum mechanics. It says, so it's really based on quantum computation, and it says that suppose that you have some reference state psi zero, a set of gates ui, there are a bunch of unitary operators in a quantum mechanical system, and some margin of error epsilon, then the complexity of any state psi is defined as the minimal number of gates that you have to apply to your reference state to get to your final state up to an error margin. So it basically tells you from a practical point of view what is the shortest quantum computer algorithm that gets you to the state that you want to have, given some initial state psi zero. Now this depends on a bunch of ingredients, it depends on the choice of psi zero and on error margin if you want, on the choice of gates. So it's actually not so clear what a quantum field theory version of this quantity is supposed to be microscopically. It's also not so clear in the quantum field theory what a good choice of gates would be. This is all sort of coming from quantum computation. But you can, on general grounds, expect that complexity keeps on growing for a very long time, even if after a system thermalizes. Because if a system thermalizes, then from the point of view of low energy observables, it might look completely thermal, but it is still exploring some complicated trajectory in the Hilbert space of the theory. And you sort of, with this definition, you can see that it takes more and more gates to make that state at later times than at early times, because it's exploring more and more complicated corners of the Hilbert space. These corners cannot be distinguished by measuring a few simple correlators. You have to look at something more complicated, but they can still be distinguished with this notion of complexity. So complexity is one of the few concepts that's available to sort of diagnose quantum systems after thermalization. So here's a picture. you know, you start system state psi 0, you apply 6 gates, and then you get very close to your final state psi. So here, this final state psi would have complexity 6. Now, in black hole backgrounds, there's also something that keeps on growing after thermalization, which is the volume of a constant time slice. And since complexity also grows, this has led to a conjecture which is called complexity equals volume, which suggests that if you find the right definition of complexity in a quantum field theory, then it might well be the case that that complexity is a quantitative measure for the volume of some interior Cauchy slice in a black hole background. That's a conjecture right now, because we cannot test it, because we don't have a precise definition of complexity to begin with for generic quantum field theories. So this is a conceptual way of thinking about the system. It seems to capture some heuristic qualitative features of many things, but it would be really nice to make some more progress and make these things more precise. So take home message of this, and then I'll race through a few paradoxes very quickly, is that black holes are extremely chaotic objects. That means in particular that the high energy spectrum of these quantum field theories must also be chaotic, because black holes have to do with the high energy spectrum of the theory. They're very hot objects with high energies. And if you translate it into field theory language, the high energy, high temperature regime of the field theory must also be extremely chaotic. And it's very hard to probe anything after the scrambling time. And complexity might be an observable like that, but we need more mathematical precise things to figure out if this really works or not. Now, I will quickly say something about a few puzzles. So the first puzzle that I want to mention briefly is about Euclidean wormholes. So if you just look at the semi-classical gravitational theory, and rather than having one boundary where a quantum field theory lives, we can also look at systems that have two boundaries. And you can find Euclidean solutions of the gravitational field equations that connect multiple boundaries. And these are kind of puzzling, because the statement was always that a single quantum field theory was dual to a gravitational theory. So if you have two quantum field theories that have nothing to do with each other, what on earth does it mean that there is a connected geometry connecting the two? You would think that they should not be talking to each other. But the standard recipes for this AGCFT correspondence tell us that there's also other solutions that connect these two theories that a priori were completely uncorrelated from each other. Now, correlations between theories can arise when you have, for example, some disorder average. If you have a field theory that depends on a parameter, and we're told to average over that parameter, then you can have correlations between two theories. But if you don't have that, then it's weird. So the puzzle is as follows. You would think that the partition function of a theory is a number. So this is a number, and this is a number, and this number is computed by this thing here, and this number is computed by this thing here. However, if you compute the product of the two numbers, you find this plus something else. But if these are just numbers, this is clearly ridiculous. So something else must be going on, because if these cannot just be numbers, because this wouldn't make any sense. Now, if you had disorder averages in the theory, say some hidden parameters alpha, and these theories would depend on some hidden parameter alpha, then you would be instructed to average over those extra parameters alpha, then this equation would be fine, because clearly the left and the right are not equal because of the averaging over this parameter alpha. And this has led people to suggest that perhaps fundamentally in any theory of quantum gravity, we have to average over some hidden parameters, some version of disorder of some sort. But then you ask, you know, what parameters are those? What do they mean? And why didn't we see them when we looked at the single theory and so on? So this is very puzzling. But actually, the idea is not completely new. This is something that was originally suggested already in the 80s by Coleman and Strominger and Giddings and so on, where they thought about baby universes. Because any space-time, you can take a point and take a little baby universe, which is like a loop of very tiny universe and connect it to somewhere else in the universe. And they argued that this would fundamentally make all the coupling constants in nature statistical. But there is a different perspective that goes as follows. So these wormholes, they exist in a low-energy effective theory. It's not a fundamental theory, it's a low-energy gravitational theory. And that low-energy theory has no detailed access to the high-energy part of the spectrum. We, as observers, cannot measure the details of the high-energy part of the spectrum. That has to do with the fact that it's, you know, a very chaotic system. So as a low-energy observer, we lack the resolution to measure precisely the high-energy spectrum. And if you don't know details of a system, there is a very nice way how to model the system. It uses statistical mechanics. What you do in statistical mechanics, one way to phrase that, is that you input all your low-energy observations, but then you maximize the ignorance that you have about the system. The canonical ensemble of statistical mechanics can simply be obtained by maximizing the entropy of a system consistent with the fact that the energy is fixed. It's a little variational exercise. But more generally, maybe this is the right way we should think about the semi-classical theory, is that we should simply interpret it in a statistical sense, in the spirit of statistical physics, and simply maximize some quantitative notion of ignorance, the entropy or something like that, in such a way that we are compatible with low-energy observations. And this way of thinking about complicated systems dates presumably back to Wigner, when he tried to use random matrix theory to model the spectrum of heavy nuclei in the 50s. Again, it was a complicated system, you didn't know the details, so you just modeled it by a random system, and you could get some features right. If you do this, then you do get an average over theories, but it's not something fundamental, it is due to limitations that you have as a low-energy observer. So you get some sort of matrix model, which describes an ensemble of Hamiltonians. So the statement is roughly that, from this point of view, semi-classical gravity, not the fundamental theory, but the low-energy effective field theory, should really be thought of as being described by an integral, an average, over all Hamiltonians that are all indistinguishable from a low-energy point of view. You simply cannot distinguish all those Hamiltonians from each other. And this is not fundamental. There is no fundamental statement that quantum gravity is intrinsically averaged. The statement is simply that there is an apparent notion of averaging that has to do with ignorance that you have as a low-energy observer. And if you take this point of view, the wormhole is simply given by doing this kind of computation. Because you're doing some sort of average now, you now get a connected contribution to the product of two partition functions. If this is correct, then you get two predictions. The first prediction is that there's no new information in these wormholes. You can predict what they are if you model precisely this measure on the space of Hamiltonians. Right? On the previous slide, there's a precise computation here. I first need to find this ensemble of Hamiltonians, and those are the things indistinguishable by low energy observers, and then you just plug it into this equation, and it gets a prediction for the wormhole. So there's no new information, you can predict what wormholes are, and the other prediction is that this was all based on ignorance, and if we don't have ignorance anymore, the wormhole should go away, because then we just have a single Hamiltonian. So we managed to collect a lot of evidence that this is the right way to think about the problem. So this seems a very nice, compelling explanation for what these wormholes mean. Maybe as a quick two quick side comments. So from this point of view, we also seem to be able to derive some sort of mixed matrix tensor model that describes pure 3D gravity, which is interesting because it seems to give us some combinatorial description of geometry that just arises from this thinking. And maybe the second comment I wanted to make is that you can ask if these wormholes should all disappear in the UV theory, once you have exact knowledge, what is the general mechanism? And I think the answer for that is believed to be, but there's still debate on that, is that typically they are unstable because of brain nucleation. The rough cartoon is that any wormhole is supported by some flux. If you know the mechanism of Schwinger pair production, that tells you that if you have a constant electric field, you create electron-positron pairs that will sort of try to lower the field. The flux that goes to the wormhole has a similar feature. There's always objects in string theory that are charged under that flux, typically D brains or something. You can create those pairs of brains. They would, say, nucleate in the middle of the wormhole throat, and there would be more and more of those. They would reduce the flux, and ultimately the flux would be gone, and the wormhole would collapse. But there is some work to be done to make that more precise. Let me not summarize this and just flash through the last two puzzles, because I'm pretty much out of time, I think. So the information paradox is this conflict that I mentioned before. And now you can do more precise computations in the following sense. So you have this, you put the black hole in a box, but a black hole in a box does not evaporate. Now what you do is you couple the box to a second system and you collect all the radiation in the second system. And then you can ask, once this black hole has completely evaporated and you now have all this radiation in the second system, whether that's in a pure state or not. And you can do a computation in this way in AGS-CFT, and you indeed find that if you compute the entropy of all the radiation, that it first goes up, but when the black hole is about half its size, it goes down again. And that shows you that at the end of the day, you do get a pure state, and unitarity is fine. The computation for the people in the lectures, the computation involves some replica type trick. You have to cut some intervals in some manifolds, and you have to look at saddle points. And then you find there's two different choices of geometry. And at early times, one geometry dominates the computation, but then at late times, a different geometry dominates the computation. And that's how you see that at the end of the day, you get a pure state. Now you could ask, what at the end of the day is the essence of the mechanism that restores unitarity? So this is my stupid explanation of what is going on. So we had to give up one of three things, namely locality or unitarity or the equivalence principle. What I think you could say happens here is that locality is the thing that has gone away. But locality has been sacrificed in such a minimal way that as a low-energy observer, you will never see it. Because all the violations of locality are exponentially small. But you see, if you take this matrix here, so this is a nice example of a mixed state. This is a density matrix. It has a bunch of non-zero eigenvalues. This is a mixed state. If you add very, very tiny corrections to it in this way, and you put them everywhere in the matrix, then suddenly it's a pure state. So the difference between a mixed state and a pure state is just a lot of exponentially small corrections. And this is essentially what's going on in the information paradox. By the way, you have to put them everywhere. That means that there's very tiny non-locality, but it's happening at all length scales. And if you think a bit about this wormhole computation and what it really does, then one way to think about what's happening is something along these lines. But none of these off-diagonal elements have any impact on any low-energy computation. They all wash away if you do like a low-energy computation. You have to do something incredibly difficult if you wanted to see the difference between these two guys. You have to look at a correlation function that involves e to the s operators or some other impossibly complicated object. So there is some tiny non-locality going on, but it's fine. It doesn't contradict anything that we know. And at the end of the day, unitarity is saved, and so is the equivalence principle. So I think that's good news. So that's how the information paradox gets resolved. Then I wanted to maybe say something about the infalling observer. I'll just say that we have worked hard and long on it, and our conclusion seems to be that you need complexity to, at the end of the day, to unambiguously answer the fate of the infalling observer. There's been a lot of work recently on black hole reconstruction and interior reconstruction, but a lot of that work is a bit circular because you assume already that you have some smooth interior, and then you show that it's not inconsistent to have that. But what you would really like to have is a construction where you assume nothing about the interior of the black hole and you construct it systematically. So what we try to do is try to see if you start from the outside, if basically coordinate patch by coordinate patch by coordinate patch, you can systematically construct a basis for the local operators. And once you go inside, behind the horizon, to do that unambiguously, you need another ingredient beyond simple correlators and so on. You need something like complexity, it seems. And it's very subtle, because if you have some operators, they might, you know, form a nice operator algebra, but you do not know whether they are actually the local operators of the theory. Because if you have a bunch of operators, and you conjugate all these operators by the same unitary, you don't really change the algebra. It's just some unitary equivalence. But that unitary could be very non-local. So just looking at an algebra by itself doesn't tell you whether these are local operators or not. And the key of this interior reconstruction is precisely that you want to know the basis of local operators. And you have to resolve this unitary ambiguity, and to resolve that somehow, complexity seems to be key. So this is the take-home message at the end of the day. I rushed you through some developments in quantum gravity. I gave three green check marks to three of the five, and sort of orange to the other two. There's still some work to do, but I think we're very close to putting like five green check marks next to this. And then we have lots of other interesting things to do. Maybe as a last comment, so black holes are made up of microscopic degrees of freedom in all these languages. They're unitary, you know, systems with a finite number of degrees of freedom. And you can ask whether we have actually seen signs of those microstates. And not really. You can do different computations. You can sort of guess what the exact things should look like. In particular, these things are supposed to have, it's all exaggerated, don't look at the scales. There's some noise here, where this noise is related to the microscopic structure. It's related to the microscopic details. But if you do a gravitational computation, then you get your smooth curves. You don't see these noise things. And now you could throw in some more non-perturbative stuff, and you get some features of the noise, but not the actual noise itself. And if you wanted to see the actual atoms, the actual molecules that make up the black hole, you would like to see those individual wiggles. You would like to see the noise, because that resolves those individual degrees of freedom. And that has not been achieved. So because gravity is so chaotic, we are in the situation that, in some sense, gravity seems to be optimized to hide its quantum nature from us. That's slightly annoying if you want to sort of demonstrate quantum gravity in an experiment, because it's so maximally chaotic that any sign of quantum gets erased as fast as possible, and it seems to have been optimized to hide its quantum nature from us. Doesn't mean that there's not still hope to see something, but that's it. So here's the conclusions. I think one thing I would like to end with is that although we have discussed this all in the context of ADS, and there you have these precise computations that you can do, it remains an important challenge to extend all these insights to other spacetimes and to come with a non-perturbative description of quantum gravity in a cosmological spacetime in particular. Let's stop there. Sorry for going a bit over time. Thank you.
Okay, so thanks very much, Ian. Questions?
What do you mean by what type of entanglement produces connected geometry is not known?
Can you repeat, sir?
What do you mean by what type of entanglement produces connected geometry is not known?
Well, if you remember, I apologize for those who were not in the lecture, but when I was describing this entanglement structure of the Minkowski vacuum in terms of these two Rinder halves, yes, that was a very particular type of entanglement. And if you perturb it somewhat, you got high energy shocks and those kinds of, yes, things on the light cone. So that's an example of such a fine-tuned entanglement. So you need a gravitational version of that statement where you explain precisely how you entangle things together. And so you have to fine-tune entanglement somewhat in order to have a smooth connected space-time. But what I mean by fine-tune, I don't know precisely.
Okay, thank you.
More questions?
So you mentioned that the when you're talking about like the statistical nature and the Euclidean wormholes, that this seemed to be kind of a consequence of maybe a lack of knowledge about, you know, the specifics of black hole microstates and whatnot. I was wondering if you know about when we consider top-down constructions of ADS-CFT in like some specific string theory situation, whether there's any examples where you have, you know, a space-time with two disconnected two disconnected boundaries where you do get, you know, like a separate kind of gauge theory, conformal field theory of both boundaries, and there's no factorization problem.
Well, you mean that you can prove that wormholes don't exist in those cases? That's basically, yeah. That's a bit hard because the rules of the game for these wormholes are also, subject of discussion. There are clearly cases where you don't have a naive wormhole.
Okay.
The main technical obstruction to consider sort of plain vanilla wormholes is that you basically have a space-time and it shrinks and it has to expand again. So it has to go through something that in cosmology people would call a bounce. Although it's Euclidean, it's a bit similar to a bounce. Now in cosmology, bounces are forbidden by energy, energy considerations like the null energy condition and so on. And typically, this is what makes it very difficult, because if you really want to do this classically, then you have to basically violate some energy condition. So the simplest example where this naively exists is to have a boundary geometry with a negative curvature. Because that negative curvature of the boundary geometry basically violates the energy in the right way to be able to stabilize the thing. Now that we can only do in two dimensions, because in higher dimensions, if you put a conformal field theory on a space with a negative curvature, those theories are generically unstable because scalars couple to the curvature. Curvature is negative, scalars get a negative mass, they're tachyonic, and so on. But the 2D CFT is fine. So the simplest example is the genus 2 Riemann surface, which has made a constant negative curvature metric, and that has somehow a nice classical wormhole like that.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, here we go. I'll go there. Yeah.
So first of all, congrats on our 28th anniversary, wedding anniversary, and thank you for the nice talk. And I want to ask you if your description of the chaos in black holes and the information destruction that you mentioned, is that related to the information paradox, or the information paradox is different from this? Because they were in different parts of our talk.
Yeah.
And I think the first one, the chaotic, it's that in principle the information is there. It's like a classical chaos. So is that, that's the question.
Yeah, that's right. So in it's related in the sense that so the information paradox was a paradox that was formulated using low energy observers, basically. And they have limited accuracy to measure things. So if you have classical chaos and you have a bound on how accurately you can measure things, then there's a finite time scale beyond which you lose anything, right? And the same is true here. So after this scrambling time, basically low energy observers, they are no longer able to resolve this information. Yeah. But then you can ask but if I make more precise measurements, yeah, and then there's precisely when Hawking's computation comes in, because if you try to do more precise computations, it looks like you still cannot get the information out. And this is where the information paradox is. So it starts with this chaotic thing, and these things are connected, but then there's a more refined argument that tells you that, but even if you had more precision, but you still do the sort of things that low energy observers would do, you can still not get it out. You really have to throw in a new ingredient to get the information out. Yeah. Yeah.
One more question.
My question is about your comment of when you said that you can understanding quantum gravity in ADS would also help us answer questions in flat space if you're looking at local stuff. But you also mentioned that the quantum mechanic, quantum gravitational degrees of freedom have to be non-local. Do you really think that we can find a quantum gravity theory which is compatible with ADS and do some actual experiments? I mean, it's not like if we are all powerful, no technological bounds, it would match the predictions of, say, flat space quantum gravity. Because I feel these two things are not compatible, right? If you are, you see where my question is.
Yeah, this now becomes a question of scaling limits. So it's true that the degrees of freedom are non-local, but are they really that non-local that it's impossible to do this? So, for example, there's a well-known procedure to get the perturbative S-matrix and flat space from taking some ADS computation and taking a particular limit of it. That's not a full non-perturbative statement. That's a perturbative S-matrix, but that's possible. I don't know if you can reliably argue that taking a limit of ADS gives you a non-perturbative description of quantum gravity in flat space. I don't know if you can argue that reliably, but certainly perturbatively it seems fine.
Thank you.
One and the last, yes.
Hi, I want to ask if there's a relation between the incorporation of these wormholes on the calculation of the entropy or the of the evaporating black hole and the non-coherent states that could exist in these two different CFTs that lives in different in the boundaries.
Sorry, the non-coherent state. What's
yes, we know that the coherent states are related to dual to black holes at finite temperature. The CFT at finite temperature is dual to the geometry of this particular solution of the Einstein equation. But the fact that you are now considering also wormholes in the bulk. Is that related to the fact that this CFT lives in different parts of the boundary, or?
Yeah, this is these wormholes have to do with two different theories living in the boundary, but also it's very much an issue with Euclidean wormholes, because I also said there is some relation between connected spacetimes and entanglement, but that's relevant in Lorentzian signature. So in Lorentzian signature, there is no problem having two boundaries that are connected together. Because there, the interpretation is simply that means that the states of the theories are entangled. So the Lorentzian connections of this type are much less mysterious. The puzzle sits in these Euclidean things, because those don't have an explanation in terms of entanglement, and they are much more confusing. But yeah, Lorentzian connections, we think, are all due to entanglement.
Okay, thank you.
All right. So I suggest that we thank Jan very much for the very nice talk. Okay. And so remember, for those who want to ask more questions, we have a question and answer session later. And let's take 10 minutes in the suggestion of Horacio, yeah? And then we start with Professor Berlinde's talk, okay?